He is the Lord, mighty in the battle, fighting for us and with us, standing by our side. We're here to honor him, to glorify him today. I'm glad that you're here. Would you take a moment to greet those around you? Welcome to worship. Some friends with me on stage today. Join us as we sing together, as we honor our Lord and our Savior. Let's lift our voices.
We've waited for this day. We're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth.
And lift your voices and sing this song to our Lord.
Your presence in this place, your glory on our face. We're looking to the sky, descending like a cloud. You're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the
God's people said, amen. Thank you. Please be seated.
Children, that's beautiful. Thank you for sharing with us in both services and doing so well, and the praise team over here for your worship leadership today. I'm glad you're here. Welcome to First Baptist Church of Alexandria on an absolutely gorgeous day. It seems like spring, but not yet. We'll wait a little bit longer for that. But it's a beautiful day to be in God's house, so thank you for coming. Now, I've met some guests, and I know there are others I've not met yet. I hope we get to chat a little bit before the service is over. But if you are new to our church, if you'll look at your program, you'll see in it a panel that asked information. And if you don't mind telling us about yourself, fill that out, tear it off, and put it in the offering plate at the end of the service. Also, anybody who's got prayer requests, you can use that too. Write it down there and put it in the offering plate, and we will see it. Let's pray together. Dear God in heaven, we are so thankful for the night's rest and that we woke up today to a beautiful, beautiful morning. We pray that in everything we think and say and do today, we will honor you. Starting in this service, Lord, we pray for those who are sick, those who are facing any difficulty in their life, a loss perhaps, Lord, your touch is needed. And I pray through this service, you will speak to each life and give them what they need. For those who are watching, we pray a special blessing. And may they join us soon and be with us in this place. We commit this time to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praising him all the day long because we can lean on his everlasting arms. Would you stand? Let's continue our worship together.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine.
What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all. Thank you. Please be seated.
Good singing. Good to see you. Good fellowship. We're starting the day out just right, and it's going to be a wonderful week, too. We've got a special guest with us today. I want Elvis Zafik to come up here. Elvis is with the Croatian Baptist Aid, and he's in our country. Connecting with partners, we partner with him through Virginia Baptist, and he's with us today. Elvis, it's good to have you. I'm meeting you for the first time today, and it's a joy to get to know you a little bit. Tell us about your journey a little bit.
It's a great privilege to bring you greetings from Balkans, and I want to thank organizers Don and Wayne for putting Balkans this morning today. My journey starts in a former Yugoslavia. Today is the country that contains from a seven different country. Everything is really mixed up. As a famous poet, Robert Frost, said, we are not confused, we are just very well mixed. So, and that's true. My mom comes from Serbia in Bosnia, meets father in Bosnia, and I come as a new product of their love. And actually, in 97, after the Bosnian War, the first group of the missionaries arrives and brings hope to us, and that's the first time when my parents and I became Christians. And I said, hope is the ability to hear the music from the future, but the faith is courage to dance to it in a presence. And this small group of the missionary came down and brought the good news. And so I became a student at that time of the theology seminary in Croatia. And again, everything went mixed. Went going from Bosnia to Croatia to study, to learn more about the Jesus. And so I want to use the opportunity to thank you all, to God, through Jesus Christ, for all of you here, because your faith became a part of our lives there.
That's great. Now, you've got a crisis going on with refugees in Bosnia. Tell me about it.
So 2015, as you all know, some of you probably read in the news, the biggest wave of refugees hit the Europe. Thousands, hundred thousands, million people are arriving daily in the Europe. And so at the time I was a student in city on the border between Croatia and Serbia, I became involved. I reached out to the pastor of the Baptist denomination and the leader of the Pentecostal denomination and said, people, we have to be involved. Church needs to find its purpose under this divine plan and the purpose. Today, biggest two enemies for our Christian faith in the Europe are indifference and intolerance. And so if we don't act, or if we act, and how we act or not act will determine our human rights tomorrow. We have to be involved because that's the core constitution of the kingdom of God, the Sermon on the Mountain. Deeply driven by that, by my faith, went down to respond with everything I could to the refugee crisis to meet their needs. As we're covering needs, we are really discovering God. And we had a beautiful team from this church who came to serve down. And so that was also big encouragement for us, for our small communities, because this is a mega church for us. We are churches like 30, 50 people. And so we do actually respond to this crisis in several different aspects, covering their needs in a food, NFI, non-food items, bags, socks, but also we are providing the water, hygiene and sanitation in the camps. In Southeastern Europe, we are providing the counseling, we are providing the English courses, and we also have a faith-based Christian communities in those camps, and Pastor Wayne had a chance to pray for those Christians. It's a small number of people, but what is a good God, it's opening great door for the good news. But when God opens the great door, he also gives the great challenge. So majority of people never had a chance to hear the gospel. And so they are meeting and coming to the Christian Europe and trying to and learning and seeing that the Christians are those who are responding. And so as the crisis is developing, before a few years ago, Berlin stood as the biggest brutal expression of division between the free Western countries and communist Eastern countries. Now this wall does not exist, but it really exists in the hearts of and minds of people. The Europe went radically against the migrants and refugees. And in the core Jesus teaching, we have to be aware that we cannot be, we cannot allow ourselves to be not indifferent over the situation. Church has a place to respond, and so we are responding. And I want to thank you to use this opportunity for your support and your prayers.
Well, we're glad to partner with you in the great work you're doing. Could I pray for you now?
Yes.
Let's do that. Father, I thank you for Elvis. I thank you for his Christian walk and his commitment to your call upon his life. I pray for the work he's doing. And Lord, I pray for the refugees in that part of the world, that you might show them through acts of kindness and care the true gospel of Christ, and that multitudes will come to faith in Jesus too. Lord, I commit him to you now. Take care of him and his work. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's thank him for being with us today. And Elvis will be around after the service if you'd like to meet him and talk to him a little bit and ask him questions. We're going to continue on with our series of talks entitled, What Would You Say? How to Find the Words for Difficult Situations. The first week we talked about how to talk to God about people. And last Sunday, if you were here, you'll remember, we talked about how to talk to people about Jesus. Today, I want to talk with you about what to say when a Christian is suffering. You're going to have those opportunities. They come out of nowhere, seemingly, when you are called upon to do something or say something in the face of tragedy. There's a listening guide in your program. Go ahead and get it out and jot down a word or two that you can take home with you that will help you. You remember Lucy and Peanuts? She had that little kiosk outside, psychiatric help, 5 cents. Remember that? Her advice wasn't that good. Sometimes I guess it might have been rather practical. Well, you're not Lucy, but sometimes you're called upon to be Dr. Phil or to be Maury or somebody who says a word at just the right moment that maybe can make a difference. The Apostle Paul wrote in Romans chapter 15 that we are all of us. This is in Romans 15 verse 14. He knows that we are competent to instruct or counsel one another. Competent. That's a good word. I'm here to tell you today that you are competent. If you're a Christian, you're competent to counsel other people. They may come to you with questions about, which college to go to, and you can recommend yours, or what careers should they consider, or should they buy that house or rent instead, and you give your advice, and that's good. But sometimes you and I are called upon to say something to somebody in the midst of great suffering. Somebody has died. Somebody has gotten a diagnosis that does not look good. And they come to you, or you stumble into the situation. You're called upon to be there and to say something. What do you say in moments like those? Well, if you're looking at the listening guide, you will see that I have started this talk with a list of things not to say, a big blank on your listening guide, things not to say, and that blank could be a lot bigger. These are some that just occurred to me. Don't say this. You must never question God. Never question God. This was God's will. Well, His permissive will, he allowed it to happen. It wouldn't have happened if he hadn't allowed it. But that doesn't mean this is what God wants for you. Bad things happen. Everything happens for a reason. I get that all the time. Everything happens for a reason. I'm not sure about that. There are many reasons why things happen. Sin is one of them. Carelessness is another one of them. Doesn't mean that God planned it. Here's one I hear often, and I don't correct it on the spot, but I'm correcting it now. Well, God just needed another angel in heaven. That's why he took your baby. No, God, if God needs another angel, he'll create one. Angels are created beings. You're not an angel. Nobody you know is going to be an angel. No, don't say that. Or God needed another flower. He picked another flower for his bouquet. That is not comforting to somebody at a time of loss. You can have another baby. This is not the time to talk about that. Remember, the Bible says all things work together for good. And a smile is on your face as you say it. That's really not what Romans 8:28 says. Actually, that verse says, and we know that in all things, God works together for good. Things aren't good. Some things are bad. They're always going to be bad. Cancer's bad. A drunk driver hitting your loved one, that's bad. That's not God's will. What the text says, Romans 8:28, is God is able to take all things, good and bad, and if we surrender them to him, he was able to bring good out of them. And don't say this, I know exactly what you're going through. No, you don't. You can't know exactly what that person is facing. And even if you think you do, they don't need to hear that. What else can you say? Turn to the book of Job, would you? Job chapter 2. Very familiar story. I think you know it, at least the contours of it. You know that Job in chapter 1 was a very righteous man and a very wealthy man. He had everything. He had everything you could possibly want. He was leading the life. And then things began to happen with God's permission. God's permission. He lost all of his wealth. The stock market crashed, and he's got a portfolio that anybody would envy one day, and then it's all gone. He lost his family. And then finally, he became deathly ill himself. Boils all over his body. No one has suffered like Job has suffered. Well, his wife told him, why don't you just curse God and die? How's that for good counsel from your wife? Imagine being married to her. Curse God and die. She's thinking about the life insurance policy, but she doesn't know he's already lost that too. Curse God and die. Well, happily, luckily for Job, he had three friends, and when they hear about what's happened, they come to see their friend. This is chapter 2, verse 11. When Job's three friends, Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Naamathite, heard about all the troubles that had come upon him, they set out from their homes and met together by agreement to go and sympathize with him and comfort him. When they saw Job from a distance, they could hardly recognize him. They began to weep aloud, and they tore their robes and sprinkled dust on their heads. Now, we do that on Ash Wednesday, a little bit of ashes or dust on the forehead. It's a sign of humility and repentance. Then they sat on the ground with him for 7 days and seven nights. No one said a word to him because they saw how great his suffering was. God's word for us today. Well, I don't need a lot of space to tell you what to say, because words are not that important after all. The most important thing when tragedy strikes is your presence. Your presence. Being there. Showing up. makes all the difference. These three friends show up, and if you know the rest of the book of Job, they do open their mouths finally, and they are loaded with advice, and most of it's bad. The best thing they do is right here in the paragraph we just read. They showed up. It's only when they opened their mouths that they got in trouble. They were there for their friend. I like what the old Quaker said. I know no words to speak to thee, but I am with thee in the grieving silence. Just showing up, crying, sitting down, holding their hand, embracing them. You do not have to try to explain the inexplicable. There's a great mystery about so much that happens in life. You don't have to explain it, and you don't have to defend God. Sometimes we Christians think we've got to defend God. If we don't say the right thing, they're going to lose their faith, and God's going to be discredited. God can handle himself. He's all right. You don't have to defend or explain him. If you don't know what to say, take somebody with you. That's what these three guys do. They park their cars in a parking lot at the mall and get in one car, and they go to see their friend. Maybe between the three of them, they'll do the right thing. And as they see him from a distance, they can see how he is disheveled and his body is contorted and how empty and sad he is, and they join right in, and they embrace him, they hug him, they sit down, and for 7 days they don't say a word. Presence is the most important thing. Now, you may not believe it, but you are prepared for this moment. This moment that you've suddenly stumbled into, you got some words you weren't expecting to hear. You've been prepared for this. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, listen to this, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3, the God of all comfort comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. For just as we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, so also our comfort abounds through Christ. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort. Do you know what he's saying? Christians experience things in our lives. One of the reasons we experience those things is God is getting us ready to share his comfort with others. He gives it to us so we can give it to them. So right now, today, if you're experiencing some great difficulty in your life, I know you're struggling with it, and you're going to get through it, but while you're going through it, comfort yourself with the idea that God is going to strengthen you through this, and he's getting you ready to make a big impact on somebody else's life. So don't waste your sorrows. Don't waste this time of pain. You're going through it, and who knows how long it will last. The Bible says that in the long run, it's really not a long period of time, but that's all relative, of course. And however long it takes to get through it, when you get on the other side, God is going to use you. Somebody had a miscarriage, and you did too. So you can talk to them in a way nobody else can. You've had breast cancer. You can talk to that person with knowledge and compassion better than anybody else. Don't waste those sorrows. Jackie Cooper was a child actor in the 1930s. He was in the Our Gang series and other things. In 1931, he starred in a movie called Skippy. He was 9 years old. His uncle was the director of the picture. He went on to be an adult actor and producer, and he had a long and distinguished career. But his first big success was in 1931 with that movie, Skippy. Skippy's not about a dog. He's Skippy in the film, if you ever get a chance to see it. Well, there was a scene in the film that called for Cooper to cry. And you've probably wondered, how do actors cry on cue? And maybe adult actors and actresses learn to do it, but he's just a child. But there was a scene where he had to cry, and he wasn't doing it, and they needed him to cry. So the director of the movie, his uncle, told a security guard to take Cooper's dog out back and pretend to shoot it. And then, when the scene came in the movie for him to cry, the director told Jackie, "Your dog just died." And he began to cry. They filmed it. It made the movie. And he was nominated for the best actor that year for that film. And he was the first and youngest. For 50 years, that record stood. His uncle, by the way, won the Academy Award for Best Director. But I don't think so. I don't think that's a good way to do. But they used the crying to put it in the film. Now, it so traumatized Jackie Cooper that later, as an adult, he wrote his autobiography. The title, "Please Don't Shoot My Dog." Now, I told you that to say they were using pain and suffering to make something good come from it. And you can use your sorrows, the experiences you've had, to make a difference. I've told you this story before, but many years ago, it was the day we drove our son to college at Wilmington, North Carolina. He was going to UNC, and we took a friend of his who wasn't going to school, and the four of us drove down to Wilmington, and it was a sad ride. And then we dropped our son off, and we're on our way back to Danville, and nobody's talking. His best friend in the car, mom and dad here, we're not saying a word. We're just kind of feeling sorry for ourselves. Then we get a phone call from back in Danville. It was a young family telling us that their 5-year-old son had just been diagnosed with leukemia and had been taken to Duke Hospital in Durham. Well, we were going right by there, so we stopped and visited with him for a little while. Imagine a 5-year-old with leukemia and how that family's world turned upside down. I didn't know what to say. But back in Danville, there was a young girl who had recently beaten cancer herself. And when she heard about her little friend in the same neighborhood, when she heard about him, she said, "I must go see him." So her mom and dad took her to Durham. And when she walked in the room, she tried to encourage him that things would be all right. And when she walked out, my little 5-year-old friend said to his parents, "You know, if she can beat it, maybe I can too. If she's well, maybe I'll be made well too." And the good news is he was. He's grown up today, a successful young man. He beat the cancer. But it was the words of somebody who had been there that made the difference. Don't waste the experiences you've had in your life. And don't forget prayer. Prayer is a gift that you can give. If you don't have words to speak, you can at least pray. I've had it happen, but very rarely, that somebody would turn down my request to pray for them. Usually, people will say, "Yes, you may pray for me." And then you have a chance to talk to God on their behalf. That's a comfort. They may not believe. They used to believe, but they don't now because of all that's happened to them. They have cried out, "Where is God?" And they're in a time of doubt or disbelief. But you believe, so let your prayers carry them for a while. You believe for them for a while. Don't forget prayer as a gift. And the last thing I would say is, do practical things. Provide practical help to those going through a difficulty. Now, you know what we all say? We all say, "If there's anything I can do," and we just drop it right there because everybody knows the end of the sentence. If there's anything I can do, please let me know. We say that, and what happens? They never ask for anything. They never call for anything, and so we never do anything. Don't say it like that. Listen to these words from James. James chapter 2, verse 14. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if somebody claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by action, is dead. That's what Elvis and his people are doing. They're seeking to win people to faith in Christ. But in the face of such enormous physical needs, how can you turn away from that? There are people in our own community, in our own nation, in great need. How can we turn away from them and expect to win them to faith in Christ? Do practical things. Volunteer to go to the airport to pick up relatives. Suggest it. Open your spare bedroom for them. Prepare a meal. Cut the grass. Do something to help them out in this time of their great need. I was rereading my journal from 2006 this week. I hadn't been here but just a few months, January 2006, and I read about a lady named Bertha Cumby. She used to live across the street from our church. And on this particular day in January, there was a Bible study during the day, and she was always there, but she wasn't there. And the seniors were leaving for a trip, and she always went, but she wasn't there. She didn't show up. And so Iva Hudgens and I walked across the street to see what was wrong. We knocked on the door, no answer. We knocked again. Then I went and I peered through the window, and I saw Bertha laying on the sofa, fully dressed, arms folded, at peace. So I knocked again. But it was obvious by now something was wrong. We called the rescue people and they came. They knocked the door in and went in, and Bertha had died. She had died peacefully while getting ready to go to Bible study and her trip. Well, what to do? She had no family close by at all. What? We were her family. What to do? Chuck Holloman was our church administrator back in those days. They now live in Colorado, but he was our administrator. And Chuck was, if you remember him, kind of stern and a little bit intimidating, you know, a man of very few words. He wouldn't have known what to say. But here's what Chuck did. He rolled up his sleeves and went in the kitchen and began to wash the dishes. That's something he knew how to do. And he did it. I rolled up my sleeves and joined him. Bill Harris, her friend and executor of her estate, we called him and he came. Archie Doring, our building superintendent, he can be rather intimidating too, don't you think? But he came over without being asked and fixed the door, prepared the door so that the house was secure. A door that looked out over the steeple of First Baptist Church, her family. And I wrote in my journal, we were the church today. Yeah, do practical things. It's as important as anything else. So here's what I'm saying. You don't know when it's going to happen. It could happen this week. You go into work and somebody's got a sad frown on their face and you say, how are you doing? And they say, not so good. You could walk away or you could say, what's wrong? And then the floodgates open. And you just stumbled into tragedy. What do you do? Well, embrace them. It's not going to be your words of wisdom. Embrace them. Pray for them. Draw from your own sadness and your own experiences to comfort them. And then volunteer to do something that will help them make it through the day. We're all of us, everyone here can do that. And that's what we're called to do as God's people in this hour. Let's pray. Would you bow with me, please? In a moment, we're going to sing, and I'm going to stand at the front of the aisle. If you want to be a part of this church, you want to be a part. I tell you, the doors are open for you. Just step out and come. I'll be at the front. You come and let me know your desire. If you'd like to know Jesus and give him your heart and trust him with your life, you step out and come. Or if you've done it recently, but you've never made it public, and you need to do that. You ought to be baptized in the days ahead. You step out and come too. Father, bless now your word to our hearing, and Lord, may we respond to your call that we might be the people you want us to be in our generation. Through Christ we pray. Amen. Let's stand and we sing.
So much. Please be seated.
Good morning, First Baptist Church family. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, teach us understanding and compassion for others that we may build up instead of tearing down. Kindle in our hearts a love that radiates sympathy as we respond not just with words, but deeds of kindness and generosity, demonstrating the love of your Son, Jesus Christ. Most holy God, help us to cast all of our burdens on you and trust you to meet those needs. God, thank you for the gifts in our lives. May we always use them to build up your church through our tithes and offerings and glorify you. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, amen.